What, if anything, would you have done differently in your life?
If I think back, I think I did whatever I wanted to do in my life, and then more or less I managed to live my life the way I wanted it, and I got away with it. And I think that's very important.
Which do you think you have the most talent, intelligence, education, or persistence?
I think all of the above.
Hello, I'm Peter Zeller, and this is Emma Zeller. And today we will be interviewing Walter Zeller on July 17th, 2008. This guy behind me, and we're going to learn all about him.
Walter Zeller. I have a middle name, but I never used it, and I don't really know what it is.
Why don't you know what your middle name is?
Because it never interested me. I was born April 7th, 1939. Good Friday. They told me that I was a bridge baby.
Breached?
Yeah, they had to break my legs, strained my muscles in my neck, and pulled half of an eye out in order to get born. After that, I was for about 3 months in the hospital. In case of both legs, I was having trouble with milk, so they had to feed me carrot juice. My father afterward, he massaged me and worked on me after I came out from the hospital, and everything went back to normal actually.
Walter's father's name was Sylvester Zeller, and he was born in 1906 on New Year's Eve at midnight. In some countries, Sylvester is the name used to refer to December 31st. By the age of 6, Sylvester became an orphan and went to live with his uncle on a farm. Sylvester had a stiff leg most of his life. Later, Sylvester served in the Nazi tank division during World War II. His unit commander tried to assassinate Hitler, and Sylvester was nearly killed as a result. After the war, he began an unusual hobby. That is, he was a beekeeper and had 15 to 20 beehives. Walter's mother's name was Emma Zeller. Her last name was Heusler before she married Sylvester Zeller. She was born May 28, 1908, in Aufhausen, Germany, and was very, very loving. Walter also had one younger brother named Helmut Zeller that was born in 1941. Walter was very protective of him. They'd take long walks, play soccer, and help farm.
Where were you born?
In Stuttgart, Germany. And the address was 81 Superburgstrasse.
You see, Walter Zeller was born during World War II. His earliest memories were of sirens, running for his life, houses burning, bombs raining down, and massive explosions. Homes were being destroyed because it was a terrible war. American and English planes flew in night after night, dropping parachute flares and, worst of all, bombs. Walter continued living this way until he was 5 years old. And then, one day during the war in 1944, the house next to his exploded. It was blown to bits by Allied planes. Walter and his brother and mother hid in their cellar. Suddenly, the basement ceiling collapsed, and the neighbors had to dig Walter and his family out. And so, the family decided to flee Stuttgart for a town called Aufhausen, because Walter's mother's parents lived there. They moved into Walter's aunt's house. At the end of the war, in 1945, Walter's father came to Aufhausen and built a loving home. This new house was wonderful because it had 3 bedrooms. It also had 2 bathrooms, one upstairs and one downstairs. His bedroom was originally a very tiny cubicle because the house was partially rented out to other people. But Walter didn't mind because his room was only meant for sleeping anyways. The neighborhood was a very nice place with lots of kids to play with. Walter's father was a tailor and had a workshop in Aufhausen. Originally, the Zeller family owned the tailor store, and when they didn't make money, the family changed it into a small grocery store. They sold everything there, that is, fruit, vegetables, milk. The store did very well. The Zellers were somewhat better off than most in town. Money was spent on food and clothing. Walter does not remember having toys, but he had small dogs growing up. As a child, he owned 1 pair of shoes which were worn only in the winter. He also had only 1 pair of pants. Later, when the Zeller grocery store began making money, Walter bought his first pair of lederhosen. They didn't have to worry about bombs any longer because the war was over, and there were no more sirens. The sound of sirens, which used to indicate a bombing run, had a lasting effect on Walter that even now, at 70 years old, the sound of a siren starting somewhere gives him goosebumps all over his body. But Aufhausen was a nice town, surrounded by nice-sized mountains. There's a huge volcano which has not erupted in over 10,000 years. They moved there because his mother's parents lived there. 600 to 700 people lived in Aufhausen at that time, that was nearly half of which was probably related to Walter in some way. It was a very nice, quaint town. Walter's first year in school was unusual in that there wasn't a schoolhouse because it was being occupied by American forces. Classes were held outside in the fields. Walter's favorite subjects in school were math and history and geography. His least favorite was religion. Walter was a very good student. His favorite teacher was Herr Reinhardt because he was fair and would listen. Most teachers at that time were bitter and angry, but not Herr Reinhardt. Christmas was also nice. Presents usually consisted of cookies or fresh baked goods. Songs were sung around candles. The Christmas tree was always secretly set up on Christmas Eve before being shown to the children. It was always a great surprise. According to Walter, kids are rather spoiled today. Kids are always indoors, whereas his generation was always outdoors. This may not be a bad thing, however, but it was certainly different. He had a motorcycle when he was 16. He needed it in order to get to work and technical high school. He enjoyed boxing, soccer, dancing, and motorcycle riding. Walter didn't go to college. But at 21, he left for America with the intent of staying only 1 year. He's been here 49 years.
My favorite book was the Karl May books. One was outstanding, that was Winnetou. Subconsciously, that's why I chose the United States to come over here. I thought many times about that, why I came to the United States, since I already had my own car, was in charge of a group of men, and they had a high salary. And I still threw everything away to come over here for... Actually, there was nothing lined up. I just came over here, and I couldn't even speak English. I took the train to Holland. When I came from Holland, I came with the ship, the Stadendam. I passed the Statue of Liberty, I passed Ellis Island. It was very impressive. By that time, I thought to myself, gee, what am I doing? I got no job, I got no money. I had $80 when I got off the ship. The Caritas Verband, religious organization that lived here, they have sponsored me. I came with another fellow I know from Westhausen, nobody here, and got off the ship at 8 o'clock in the morning. Somebody was supposed to pick us up and get us into the city, and by 6, 7 o'clock in the evening, still nobody was there. In the meantime, we went from ship to ship. We didn't have enough money to go home, but we said we're going to work. They need workers, we're going to work our way back. Nobody wanted to hire us. And then finally somebody showed up that couldn't speak German, we couldn't speak English. But he had a sign where he is, and he took us into Manhattan. So the next day, we walked around the neighborhood if we could find a job. And then we met somebody that said, go to that German agency, they have jobs. So we went into the subway, and we got so lost, we never made it to that German agency. So we gave it another shot. The second day, they gave us a job. They made all kinds of parts for the government. In no time, I was in charge again of a group. And then one day, when the boss was away, it was payday, I handed out the paychecks, and naturally I looked what they make. And I was the lowest paid guy. I was even lower paid than the guy that swept the floor. And I was in charge of all of them. I was so mad. I didn't do a thing that day until he came back. And I had a piece of iron in my hand. I wanted to smash his head in. And then the other people stopped me. I said, how dare? I'm the one that has everything in his hands and works and shows him how to do it and checks everything. And I'm the lowest paid guy. And I told him what he can do with his job, and I walked out. Then I went back to that agency again, and in the meantime, since I had already experience in the United States, they had me a job as a tool and die maker. All the employees there were Germans, so it was easier. I could communicate with them in my own language. And on the other hand, it was not that good because I didn't have to speak English. I had an apartment in Yorkville, which was practically at that time strictly German, German speaking, German newspaper, German radio, German stores, German restaurants. So that was another bad thing in order to learn English. You had to get away from that area, otherwise you never learn English. So and then my friend, in the meantime, Adolf, he got a job in Florida. So I went down North Miami Beach. We were young fellows. So in the evening we wanted to go out dancing and in the restaurants. Sometimes we rented a room in the Fountain Blue. That time it was $28 for the whole weekend, which was a lot of money, but you know, we were young fellows, we didn't care. It was nice down there for a while, but the money was always short, very short. So I said, heck with it, I go back to New York, which I'm going to make a lot more money, and that's what happened. I went back to New York, and that's when I started in the elevator business. A friend of mine told me there's they're looking for a machinist to replace, just to help out for 2 weeks. While the guy is on vacation, all you have to do is, you know, fix the parts and so. And then we see what happens after that. So I started with that company that was called Smith Elevator. And after the other guy came back from vacation, my boss says, you stay here. That's how I started in the elevator business, and then the rest was history. I was very talented in fixing things, and I had a very logical mind when you do machineries and so when you have to come in. That's why I became known to the elevator field. With all this it was, which I was very proud to say, they called me after their engineers couldn't see daylight. Then they always said, okay, we have to call Walter in. And usually I had it done in no time.
He worked most of his time for an elevator company called McGlynn & Hayes and retired when he was 65. When asked if he liked working in the elevator business, he said, sure, it has its ups and downs. While working in Chinatown in New York City, Walter was called in for a Chinese crime boss. When Walter was ushered into a room, he found himself surrounded by heavily armed guards and long tables stacked high with money. The crime boss sat behind the money. When Walter asked what the crime boss needed, he told Walter that he wanted the voice of the elevator changed. Walter changed the voice, and the crime boss gave him a card that allowed him to eat for free in the best Chinese restaurants in Chinatown. But Walter wouldn't take advantage of the card because it meant taking advantage of the restaurants themselves. Walter met Anna Gretten Mog in Yorkville, New York, which was a German neighborhood on 86th Street in Manhattan in 1962. He met her in a club called the Yorkville Casino during a New Year's dance. He took one look at her and said that was the girl that he wanted to date. Anna Gretten was sitting with her girlfriend and five other guys. Walter walked right up to her and asked her for a dance. 1.5 years later, they married on August 8, 1964. Anna Gretten was 23, Walter 25. They married in City Hall, New York City. Afterwards, they went to a German restaurant and had a very nice dinner. Today, they are still dancing and very much in love. In November of 1970, they had a daughter named Sylvia, which they named after Walter's father, Sylvester. And then, on October 21st, 1975, they were truly blessed with the arrival of a son, a great son, which they named Peter, because as Walter puts it, he just looked like a Peter. Walter and Anna Gretten raised their family in New Hyde Park, Long Island. The most memorable vacation was a trip to Germany to show the family where we all came from. Raising children was limited because Walter had to work as an elevator mechanic up to 12 hours a day. He worked in New York City. Walter is very proud of his children. Sylvia did very well at Binghamton University in upstate New York. She then married a man named Martin Beer, and thus presented her father with three beautiful grandchildren, that is, Christian, Gabriella, and Amanda. Pete joined the United States Marine Corps shortly after high school. Soon after, he went to Long Island University, otherwise known as CW Post. During his time at CW Post, he met the beautiful Andrea Midlars.
Hi.
Together, they decided to move to Washington State, where Pete received his master's degree from the University of Washington. He is currently a teacher and father of the beautiful Emma Darwin Zeller. Being a grandparent is great. Walter plays with his grandchildren, spoils them, and then, when he gets tired, he can simply go home and rest.
What have been the three biggest news events during your lifetime?
The end of World War II. When Kennedy got shot, that was a big news event. And 9/11, I sentence in the morning. And on that day, Otis was taking over the World Trade Centers. And they were supposed to come down in the morning and go through the motor rooms with the supervisors, you know, go through everything and see. But I was delayed, and instead of going there, being there before 8 o'clock, I was on my way down when the first plane hit the World Trade Center. And I watched it. I was very close already with the car on the West Side Highway. And close enough to see the people jump and all that. And I think all those problems at that time were gone, because I thanked them that I had them and I couldn't go there during the morning. And I stood there and I got very, very aggravated when I saw this, and then I saw the other plane hitting it. First I thought it was an accident, but when the other plane hit it, I know it was no more accident. But in the meantime, the cops came and told me to get off the West Side Highway with the car, get in, because it became an emergency road. So I parked in the next side street, I put the car there. I don't even know if it was or no parking, or nobody cared anyway. And I walked down again and I watched it for a while, and then I said to him, I just couldn't watch it anymore. I went into the car and drove back to the company, and in the meantime they knew, and I tried to call your mother, because I told her I'd be here in the morning in the World Trade Center. I tried to tell her I'm not there. No telephone service, nothing. So I told my secretary to keep calling every 5 minutes. Finally, we got through to your mother, and I told her I'm all right. I wasn't there yet. And she was relieved, because I know, I told her I'd be in the World Trade Center all day today again. Well, how do I feel growing old? It's nice in a way, because no more big responsibility like you had when you worked, enough money, everything all right with the family. Right now it's what they call the golden years, but it's not so golden when your body doesn't work the way it's supposed to. My father died early, and my mother, when she was alone, she was very alone, because nobody really looked in on her. My brother always visited her on and off, but she was a very lonely woman. I had the feeling she was glad when she could die. They were almost like me too. They had good times, except they couldn't do that much traveling.
How should a person prepare for old age?
Well, there is two ways. Physically, make sure you're in good health when you get there. And second of all, make sure all you have enough monies in order to have a nice retirement. And be healthy.
Thank you. Would you like to give a final message to your grandchild?
Yes. Emma, live your life as good. Be honest to yourself. My philosophy was, in the morning when I get up and looked in the mirror, and I could say, hey, I can be proud of myself because I didn't do anything bad. And that's the best policy I can think of for you to do. When you look in that mirror and you're proud of yourself, that means you're a good person and an honest person, and you don't have to be ashamed of anything. I just want to add to my grandchildren, that's Christian, Gabriela, Amanda, and Emma, and all the future grandchildren, that if I see them or not, I love them all, and I have them in my heart, and I'm very proud of them. And I hope someday that they can look back when they are 69 or 70 years old and can say we had a good life and thank God we made it that far, and hopefully they go a lot further. So I wish them all good luck on their life and all the best things, and always think on it, Grandpa has them in their heart.
Obi.
I'm Obi to all of you. Okay, so goodbye and the best to you.
Yeah. Hab ich sie geküsst. Keiner weiß, was am Geschehen ist. Ja, ja, so blau, blau, blau blüht Enzian. Wenn beim Alpen glüht, wir uns wiedersehen mit ihren roh, 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 roten Lippen fing es an, die ich nie vergessen kann. Was am Geschehen ist.
What, if anything, would you have done differently in your life?
If I think back, I think I did whatever I wanted to do in my life, and then more or less I managed to live my life the way I wanted it, and I got away with it. And I think that's very important.
Which do you think you have the most talent, intelligence, education, or persistence?
I think all of the above.
Hello, I'm Peter Zeller and this is Emma Zeller. And today we will be interviewing Walter Zeller on July 17th, 2008. This guy behind me, and we're going to learn all about him.
My name is Walter Zeller. I have a middle name, but I never used it, and I don't really know what it is.
Why don't you know what your middle name is?
Because it never interested me. I was born April 7th, 1939. Good Friday. They told me that I was a breech baby.
Breached?
Yeah, they had to break my legs, strained my muscles in my neck, and pulled half of an eye out in order to get born. After that, I was for about 3 months in the hospital. Case on both legs, I was having trouble with milk, so they had to feed me carrot juice. My father afterward, he massaged me and worked on me after I came out from the hospital, and everything went back to normal actually.
Walter's father's name was Sylvester Zeller, and he was born in 1906 on New Year's Eve at midnight. In some countries, Sylvester is the name used to refer to December 31st. By the age of six, Sylvester became an orphan and went to live with his uncle on a farm. Sylvester had a stiff leg most of his life. Later, Sylvester served in the Nazi tank division during World War II. His unit commander tried to assassinate Hitler, and Sylvester was nearly killed as a result. After the war, he began an unusual hobby. That is, he was a beekeeper and had 15 to 20 beehives. Walter's mother's name was Emma Zeller. Her last name was Heusler before she married Sylvester Zeller. She was born May 28, 1908, in Aufhausen, Germany, and was very, very loving. Walter also had one younger brother named Helmut Zeller that was born in 1941. Walter was very protective of him. They'd take long walks, play soccer, and help farm.
Where were you born?
In Stuttgart, Germany. And the address was 81 Superburgstraße.
You see, Walter Zeller was born during World War II. His earliest memories were of sirens, running for his life, houses burning, bombs raining down, and massive explosions. Homes were being destroyed because it was a terrible war. American and English planes flew in night after night, dropping parachute flares and, worst of all, bombs. Walter continued living this way until he was 5 years old. And then, one day during the war in 1944, the house next to his exploded. It was blown to bits by Allied planes. Walter and his brother and mother hid in their cellar. Suddenly, the basement ceiling collapsed, and the neighbors had to dig Walter and his family out. And so, the family decided to flee Stuttgart for a town called Aufhausen, because Walter's mother's parents lived there. They moved into Walter's aunt's house. At the end of the war, in 1945, Walter's father came to Aufhausen and built a loving home. This new house was wonderful because it had 3 bedrooms. It also had 2 bathrooms, one upstairs and one downstairs. His bedroom was originally a very tiny cubicle because the house was partially rented out to other people. But Walter didn't mind because his room was only meant for sleeping anyways. The neighborhood was a very nice place with lots of kids to play with. Walter's father was a tailor and had a workshop in Aufhausen. Originally, the Zeller family owned the tailor store, and when they didn't make money, the family changed it into a small grocery store. They sold everything there, that is, fruit, vegetables, milk. The store did very well. The Zellers were somewhat better off than most in town. Money was spent on food and clothing. Walter does not remember having toys, but he had small dogs growing up. As a child, he owned 1 pair of shoes which were worn only in the winter. He also had only 1 pair of pants. Later, when the Zeller grocery store began making money, Walter bought his first pair of lederhosen. They didn't have to worry about bombs any longer because the war was over, and there were no more sirens. The sound of sirens, which used to indicate a bombing run, had a lasting effect on Walter that even now, at 70 years old, the sound of a siren starting somewhere gives him goosebumps all over his body. But Aufhausen was a nice town, surrounded by nice-sized mountains. There's a huge volcano which has not erupted in over 10,000 years. They moved there because his mother's parents lived there. 600 to 700 people lived in Aufhausen at that time, that was nearly half of which was probably related to Walter in some way. It was a very nice, quaint town. Walter's first year in school was unusual in that there wasn't a schoolhouse because it was being occupied by American forces. Classes were held outside in the fields. Walter's favorite subjects in school were math and history and geography. His least favorite was religion. Walter was a very good student. His favorite teacher was Herr Reinhardt because he was fair and would listen. Most teachers at that time were bitter and angry, but not Herr Reinhardt. Christmas was also nice. Presents usually consisted of cookies or fresh baked goods. Songs were sung around candles. The Christmas tree was always secretly set up on Christmas Eve before being shown to the children. It was always a great surprise. According to Walter, kids are rather spoiled today. Kids are always indoors, whereas his generation was always outdoors. This may not be a bad thing, however, but it was certainly different. He had a motorcycle when he was 16. He needed it in order to get to work and technical high school. He enjoyed boxing, soccer, dancing, and motorcycle riding. Walter didn't go to college. But at 21, he left for America with the intent of staying only 1 year. He's been here 49 years.
My favorite book was to count my books. One was outstanding, that was Winnetou. Subconsciously, that's why I choose the United States to come over here. I thought many times about that, why I came to the United States, since I already had my own car, was in charge of a group of men, and they had a high salary. And I still threw everything away to come over here for... Actually, there was nothing lined up. I just came over here, and I couldn't even speak English. I took the train to Holland. When I came from Holland, I came with the ship, the Stadendam. I passed the Statue of Liberty, I passed Ellis Island. It was very impressive. By that time, I thought by myself, gee, what am I doing? I got no job, I got no money. I had $80 when I got off the ship. The Caritas Verband, religious organization that lived here, they sponsored me. I came with another fellow I know from Westhausen, nobody here, and got off the ship at 8 o'clock in the morning. Somebody was supposed to pick us up and get us into the city, and by 6, 7 o'clock in the evening, still nobody was there. In the meantime, we went from ship to ship. We didn't have enough money to go home, but we said we're going to work. They need workers. We're going to work our way back. Nobody wanted to hire us. And then finally somebody showed up that couldn't speak German. We couldn't speak English. But he had a sign where he is. And he took us into Manhattan. So the next day, and walked around the neighborhood if we could find a job. And then we met somebody that said, go to that German agency, they have jobs. So we went into the subway, and we got so lost, we never made it to that German agency. So we gave it another shot the second day. They gave us a job. They made all kinds of parts for the government. In no time, I was in charge again of a group. And then one day, when the boss was away, it was payday. I handed out the paychecks, and naturally I looked what they make. And I was the lowest paid guy. I was even lower paid than the guy that swept the floor. And I was in charge of all of them. I was so mad. I didn't do a thing that day until he came back. And I had a piece of iron in my hand. I wanted to smash his head in. And then the other people stopped me. I said, how dare I'm the one that has everything in his hands and works and shows him how to do it and checks everything. And I'm the lowest paid guy. And I told him what he can do with his job, and I walked out. Then I went back to that agency again, and in the meantime, since I had already experience in the United States, they had me a job as a tool and die maker. All the employees there were Germans. So it was easier. I could communicate with them in my own language. And on the other hand, it was not that good because I didn't have to speak English. I had an apartment in Yorkville, which was practically at that time strictly German, German speaking, German newspaper, German radio, German stores, German restaurants. So that was another bad thing in order to learn English. You had to get away from that area, otherwise you never learn English. So, and then my friend, in the meantime, Adolf, he got a job in Florida. So I went down North Miami Beach. We were young fellows, so in the evening we wanted to go out dancing and in the restaurants. Sometimes we rented a room in the Fountain Blue. That time it was $28 for the whole weekend, which was a lot of money, but my young fellow, we didn't care. It was nice down there for a while, but the money was always short, very short. So I said, heck with that, go back to New York, which I'm going to make a lot more money, and that's what happened. I went back to New York, and that's when I started in the elevator business. A friend of mine told me there's a they're looking for a machinist to replace, just to help out for 2 weeks while the guy is on vacation. All you have to do is, you know, fix the parts and so, and then we see what happens after that. So I started with that company that was called Smith Elevator. And after the other guy came back from vacation, my boss says, you stay here. That's how I started in the elevator business, and then the rest was history. I was very talented in fixing things, and I had a very logical mind when you do machineries and so when you have to come in. That's why I became known to the elevator field. With all this, it was, which I was very proud to say, they called me after their engineers couldn't see daylight. Then they always said, okay, we have to call Walter in. And usually I had it done in no time.
He worked most of his time for an elevator company called McGlynn and Hayes and retired when he was 65. When asked if he liked working in the elevator business, he said, sure, it has its ups and downs. While working in Chinatown in New York City, Walter was called in for a Chinese crime boss. When Walter was ushered into a room, he found himself surrounded by heavily armed guards and long tables stacked high with money. The crime boss sat behind the money. When Walter asked what the crime boss needed, he told Walter that he wanted the voice of the elevator changed. Walter changed the voice, and the crime boss gave him a card that allowed him to eat for free in the best Chinese restaurants in Chinatown. But Walter wouldn't take advantage of the card because it meant taking advantage of the restaurants themselves. Walter met Anna Gret Mog in Yorkville, New York, which was a German neighborhood on 86th Street in Manhattan in 1962. He met her in a club called the Yorkville Casino during a New Year's dance. He took one look at her and said that was the girl that he wanted to date. Anna Gret was sitting with her girlfriend and five other guys. Walter walked right up to her and asked her for a dance. 1.5 years later, they married on August 8, 1964. Anna Gret was 23, Walter 25. They married in City Hall, New York City. Afterwards, they went to a German restaurant and had a very nice dinner. Today, they are still dancing and very much in love. In November of 1970, they had a daughter named Sylvia, which they named after Walter's father, Sylvester. And then, on October 21st, 1975, they were truly blessed with the arrival of a son, a great son, which they named Peter, because as Walter puts it, he just looked like a Peter. Walter and Anna Gret raised their family in New Hyde Park, Long Island. The most memorable vacation was a trip to Germany to show the family where we all came from. Raising children was limited because Walter had to work as an elevator mechanic up to 12 hours a day. He worked in New York City. Walter is very proud of his children. Sylvia did very well at Binghamton University in upstate New York. She then married a man named Martin Beer, and thus presented her father with three beautiful grandchildren. That is Christian, Gabriella, and Amanda. Pete joined the United States Marine Corps shortly after high school. Soon after, he went to Long Island University, otherwise known as CW Post. During his time at CW Post, he met the beautiful Andrea Midlars.
Hi.
Together, they decided to move to Washington State, where Pete received his master's degree from the University of Washington. He is currently a teacher and father of the beautiful Emma Darwin Zeller. Being a grandparent is great. Walter plays with his grandchildren, spoils them, and then, when he gets tired, he can simply go home and rest.
What have been the three biggest news events during your lifetime?
The end of World War II. When Kennedy got shot, that was a big news event. And 9/11, supposed to go to the World Trade Center in the morning. And on that day, Otis was taking over the World Trade Center. And they were supposed to come down in the morning and go through the motor rooms with the supervisors, you know, go through everything and see. But I was delayed, and instead of going there, being there before 8 o'clock, I was on my way down when the first plane hit the World Trade Center. And I watched it. I was very close already with the car on the West Side Highway. And close enough to see the people jump and all that, and I think my all those problems at that time were gone, because I thanked them that I had them and I couldn't go there during the morning. And I stood there and I got very, very aggravated when I saw this, and then I saw the other plane hitting it. First I thought it was an accident, but when the other plane hit it, I know it was no more accident. But in the meantime, the cops came and told me to get off the West Side Highway with the car, get in, because it became an emergency road. So I parked in the next side street. I put the car there. I don't even know if it was or no parking, or nobody cared anyway. And I walked down again and I watched it for a while, and then I said to him, I just couldn't watch it anymore. I went into the car and drove back to the company, and in the meantime they knew, and I tried to call them, your mother, because I told her I'd be here in the morning in the World Trade Center. I tried to tell her I'm not there, and no telephone service, nothing. So I told my secretary to keep calling every 5 minutes. Finally we got through to your mother, and I told her I'm all right, I wasn't there yet. And she was relieved, because I know, I told her I'd be in the World Trade Center all day today again. Well, how do I feel growing old? It's nice in a way, because no more big responsibility like you had when you worked, enough money, everything all right with the family. Right now, it's what they call the golden years, but it's not so golden when your body doesn't work the way it's supposed to. My father died early, and my mother, when she was alone, she was very alone, because nobody really looked in on her. My brother always visited on and off, but she was a very lonely woman, and I had the feeling she was glad when she could die. They were almost like me too. They had good times, except they couldn't do that much traveling.
How should a person prepare for old age?
Well, there is two ways. Physically, make sure you're in good health when you get there. And second of all, make sure all you have enough monies in order to have a nice retirement and be healthy.
Would you like to give a final message to your grandchild?
Yes. Emma, live your life as good, be honest to yourself. My philosophy was in the morning when I get up and looked in the mirror, and I could say, hey, I can be proud of myself because I didn't do anything bad. And that's the best policy I can think of for you to do. When you look in that mirror and you're proud of yourself, that means you're a good person and an honest person, and you don't have to be ashamed of anything. I just want to add to my grandchildren, that's Christian, Gabriella, Amanda, and Emma, and all the future grandchildren, that if I see them or not, I love them all and I have them in my heart, and I'm very proud of them. And I hope someday that they can look back when they're 69 or 70 years old and can say we had a good life and thank God we made it that far, and hopefully they go a lot further. So I wish them all good luck on their life and all the best things, and always think on it, Grandpa has them in their heart.
Opie.
Opie. I'm Opie to all of you. Okay, so goodbye and the best to you.
Hab ich sie geküsst. Keiner weiß, was dann geschehen ist. Ja, ja, so blau, blau, blau gedenkt sie an, wenn beim Alpenglüh wir uns wiedersehen mit ihren roh, 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 roten Lippen fing es an, die ich nie vergessen kann. Wiedersehen mit ihren roh, 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 rote Lippen fing es an, ich nie. Vergessen kann. Ja, ja, so blau, blau, blau blüht ein Zian, wenn beim Alpenglüh wir uns wiedersehen mit ihren roh, 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 rote Lippen fing es an, ich nie.
In der zweiten Hütte, da haben wir zusammen gegessen. In der dritten Hütte hab ich sie geküsst. Keiner weiß, was dann geschehen ist. Holla dia dia, holla di holla di ho. In Hütte hab ich sie geküsst. Keiner weiß, was dann geschehen ist. ist. Ja, ja, so blau, blau, blau gedenkt sie an, wenn beim Alpenglühen wir uns wiedersehen mit ihren roh, 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 roten Lippen fing es an, wie ich nie vergessen kann. Ja, ja, so blau, blau, blau blüht Enzian, wenn beim Alpenglühen wir uns wiedersehen mit ihren roh, 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 roten Lippen fing es an, wie ich nie.
Is there anything I missed or you want to comment on?
No, you did a good job.